Well, welcome back. I suggest that we start with the questions of Ellen, because I understand that she has a great long trip to go back home, so that will free her hands to leave earlier if she wants to.
Thank you. You had mentioned that consciousness is a parameter, or actually it's a quantity that consists, or that has various levels, okay, if I'm not mistaken. And there are certain individuals that can not adapt, what's the term I wanted to use, that can view them, or actually are aware of them at certain levels. For instance, the one I'm more concerned about is, or not concerned, but inquiring about is the wisdom level, or the enlightenment level. Does that make that individual, are they able to, obviously they can see more things than the average human being, obviously, right? Like they can see more of a spiritual presence around them, is that the case? Can they see more? That's what
you're talking now about how, if I understood you correctly, you are asking me whether or not the other individuals, when they have in their presence somebody who's supposed to be enlightened, yes, if they can distinguish that.
Absolutely.
Now, don't forget that to be able to make this kind of observations, we assume that the particular individual is over the average.
Yes.
Okay. So that means that he has certain capacity to be able to see a greater part of what the other individual may be. And so depending on his capabilities, yeah, he may have more information than others. So in other words, As a mind process exercise, can be revealing, and there are differentiations between individuals. So yeah, you can see, but it doesn't mean that everybody sees the same.
No.
It's very unique on the individual.
And limited, I would think. I can't imagine like the average person having that capability. Obviously, it's a limited few that would, obviously.
Yes, right? You're right.
So.
Yes, you are so right. The limited few. It takes, I can explain you how it works.
Okay.
To be able to see auras, which is something that it is quite revealing of the content and the quality of the subtle energy that an individual is made of. It is the result of all of these things. So it will start with the cognitive function declaring, or the individual who can see, or is declaring his desire to be able to see the aura of the other person. He has to do that before the whole thing starts. Otherwise he will get crazy. He won't be able to drive.
Okay.
He won't be able to work.
Because
if he sees auras all the time, he will get crazy. The emotions of you at every particular moment of day can change. So the same thing applies with me and anybody else. So if you are working and you see anybody changing colors and so forth, at the end you are becoming distracted. Right? So the point is that this individual who wants to study you, for example, he thinks about your aura, and then what happens, this cognitive function starts a cognitive process that creates the aura. This is a cognitive process. literally. And then it starts up other cognitive processes that they interpret the aura. And at the end, he has his answer. Okay? That's how it works. If you don't mind, keep it close.
I befriended someone a couple of years ago. She was a colleague of mine, okay? And we traveled with a group of people together, and periodically we go to different towns in Ontario, okay? So we'd stay at bed and breakfast places and so forth. And you know how old places are like. They tend to be haunted. Haunted? Whatever you want to call them. Okay, so this person that I got to know, very nice individual, she said in one of the rooms she was able to sense that there was a spiritual presence. It was very cold in a particular area of the room. She said that she saw a woman sitting in a rocking chair. We saw nothing, obviously, just a rocking chair. Okay, so I had a hard time believing her, quite frankly, and I guess we weren't as open-minded back then. But we lost touch, and then I bumped into her on Yonge Street. The funny thing is, as she was walking towards me, she was looking down, and she didn't even notice me until she got closer to me. She immediately looked up and saw a spiritual presence around me and immediately asked me if I knew someone by the name of Marta. So I said, yes, I do. And that's my grandmother, so that's why. She felt my grandmother's presence immediately around me, always.
Very interesting.
Yeah. So that's, then I believed her now. I do believe her. And that's my question. So.
Overall, you have to be cautious with the claims of any person, any person. But on the other hand,
I've never talked about my family, so she would not have known.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah. All I'm trying to say is that many people claim a lot of things. They cannot be assured. You cannot be assured that what they say is wrong all the time or it is correct all the time. There is the element of subjectivity in them as well. Sometimes they feel strong, there is a reason to feel strong, this gift, if you wish to call it, in order to give you some piece of information. Maybe the fact is that your grandma, who recognized that she could do it, put her in a situation to reveal her presence.
Most likely, yes. Yeah.
You know, it's only a scenario, but you cannot exclude it.
No, not at all.
Don't forget, please.
Yes, yes, of course. Okay. You also mentioned consciousness. It's a parameter that, it's a quantity that consists of a very high energy frequency.
Yes.
But low, was it low density or no density? You said low.
Oh no, low density.
Low, okay.
There is density everywhere.
Okay.
Up on the top here there would be a single point. It starts with a single point. And down here you have all the universes. Okay? As far as density is concerned. If you look at the frequency, at the highest point there, you have only one point of mass, but you have all the creative energy around. So imagine what a burst of energy will come out of it and how much stuff will be created instantaneously. According to our understanding of Big Bang Theory, the first split of a second after the Big Bang, we had a great part of the universe already formed.
Okay.
Imagine how much God was thinking ahead of time.
Yes.
He had all the specifications ready.
Okay, so consciousness. Okay, so there's consciousness and subconsciousness. Are you referring also to the unconscious level as well? Like when we're unconscious?
I refer to.
Okay. So in our dreams, for instance, give a dream as an example, I've sensed in my dreams that I've been somewhere else. Okay. Problem is, I don't remember the dreams I have.
Yeah.
And then I seem to jolt, like when I wake up from a dream, I awaken suddenly, and I'm not sure why or what causes that. So, is it just, I guess, my spirit coming back into my body? I don't know.
What is your question?
My question is, why is it that we can't seem to remember our dreams for the most part?
Many people don't remember. I will give you an answer which is a continuation of your question. Why do you think that you should remember? The point is that there is a reason for everything. And you may have an encounter over there that you don't approve to remember.
Oh, so
let's say there is a reason in everything.
So let's say if it was an unpleasant encounter, obviously it wasn't meant to be remembered.
Was it an unpleasant encounter?
I don't know. I'm just saying if it were an unpleasant one, maybe that's why we're not meant to remember it.
There are too many people who don't remember their encounters, and too many people who remember a lot of things and they don't make much sense out of it. They don't even try to understand them. So, if I can tell you personal experience about dreaming, it's lots of fun. A lot of flying, a lot of running, a lot of doing things that I cannot do. So that's how I know that it is a dream, because I know that I couldn't do the same thing if it was physical.
Since you said that we are all emotional individuals and emotions are created through our thoughts,
sure.
How do we change or influence another person's emotions? Sometimes we hear that person's perception has become their reality. Many times, the actual fact is not the same as their perception. Am I making sense?
Mm-hmm. It makes sense, yeah. The reality is not really our perception. Could be our reality, but it implies that you already advanced.
So how do you change or affect somebody else's perceptions or emotions, and what at what level is it? But is it?
No, I will use a method that it is well known. We seem to have a bit of time, so if you don't mind, with a couple of phrases, you will give your own answer, if I may. Remember that I have already indicated, and you said it yourself, that emotions are the results of thoughts. So if you are to change emotions, what do you really have to change in order to change the emotions?
It's the obvious, the person's thoughts. And to change the person's thoughts,
how can you do that?
How do we do that?
By giving an opportunity to the person to start thinking again and review his thinking process, and on the basis of that come with new emotions.
Not always successful.
There's no guarantees. Okay? Like, for example, what I just mentioned is very, very important. It's a whole it's the thing to do, but no guarantees. You have to be very careful into doing these kind of things. Depends on their preferred will.
Some spirits don't want to change or change their thought process.
I'm sorry?
Some spirits probably don't want to change their thought process. They resist.
Okay. Don't push the blame to the other. Because you are there. You are there. I mean, nobody is taking you from the hand. You are not a marionette. No, you do that. You are there and you decide with the others. Therefore, you are part of the, you take part of the blame. Okay? You have free will. Your free will is yours, and then the others try to influence, but if you let them influence, then you take the blame yourself. Right? That's what free will is all about. There are always spiritual entities who are ready to mingle with you. Okay? But they are attracted by the way you resonate, how you feel. And what you feel is based on the way you are thinking, your consciousness, right? So, if you want to do something evil, to take advantage of somebody, they sense it, that you are an evil doer. Who do you think will come right away to help you if you want to do something evil?
Evil spirits? There are evil spirits?
Oh.
Yes, there is good and evil spirits?
Of course. Didn't I mention that in the group consciousness, the examples we had was Lucifer as leader of the evil group, and Saint Michael as leader of the good spirits? When I say something, you have to try to find its dimensions. Okay.
What is the difference between using someone versus accepting someone's help? For instance, you said you should not be using anyone to your advantage.
Yeah, but that refers to your victim.
Yes.
Okay? That refers to your victim. Now, if the spiritual entities who are helping you play along, that means that they are evil, and they are training you to become like them. That's why they are helping you.
But you can use someone in a good way. And the person who you're using in a good way is also accepting to help you use them.
Can you clarify it?
You said... You said it's not right to use people to your advantage.
Yeah.
Because it's evil or it's bad. But you can also use people in situations with their knowledge and acceptance that they're benefiting you.
Okay. I think we are talking about two different phenomena altogether. One is you apply your free will to impose on others and take advantage of them. Okay, that's one which is clearly evil.
Yes.
And the other one, you're getting the assistance of people for some reason, mm-hmm. which it is less evil than before.
But still, nevertheless.
Because these people, with their free will, they agree with you.
Yeah.
Okay? So it will be evil to the level that they help you impose on them. But you don't have the full blame for the whole situation. You are an accessory to murder for them. You're just an accessory versus the case when you are murdering somebody.
Yes.